Java withers, Java ages, Java decays. That was the conception I wanted to play off of when picking this episode's title, but I can't pull this off. I mean, I'm recording this video on the world's longest permanent racetrack, and I'm here because of Java, specifically Java Land, one of the very best Java conferences in a community flush with excellent events. The whole Java is dying shtick is lame anyway, but it's outright ridiculous to perform it here, so let's see whether we can find another topic that fits the title Java Withers. Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Palok, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and today we're going to talk about JDK Enhancement Proposal 468, Derived Record Creation, better known as With Expressions or just Withers. Ha, that was easy. JEP 468 proposes an elegant solution to the verbosity that managing state with immutable records can cause in everyday programming. It became a candidate JEP earlier this year, which means it's ready to be targeted to a specific release. From what I can tell, that may very well be JDK 23, but as Mike String Template Tyson once said, everybody has a plan until they get punched in the face. So, you know, let's not get ahead of ourselves. Ready? Then let's dive right in. If you're on Java 17 or newer, I'm sure you've used records. Probably a lot. They work great to model immutable data carriers, and their transparency makes them very convenient. Free constructors, free accessors, free equals and hash code, but many degrees of freedom. What's not to like? Well, there's one thing actually. Immutability is great until you need to change something. Clearly you can't mutate a record state, and so they don't have set methods, commonly referred to as setters. So the next best thing is to create a slightly changed copy. You can do that on the use side and just create a new instance of the record where all values except the one you want to change come from the old record. But that gets real old really fast. To fix that, you can move that code into the record itself. Create one method for each component that takes a new value for it and returns an appropriately copied instance. These methods usually start with the word with and are hence often called withers. This is a solid approach and it works well. But it's a bit sad that while the language understands how to construct and deconstruct a record, it doesn't combine those capabilities, and instead you have to manually drag data out of one and into the next instance. It also means that we once again end up with boilerplate code that not only needs to be written, or more likely generated, but also to be read again and again to make sure neither customizations nor errors are hiding in there. Another shortcoming of this approach is that individual withers will fail when you have constraints that span several components. Have a point that needs coordinates to either be all positive or all negative? Then you can't go from one state to the other via individual with calls, without the constructor throwing an exception in between. Then you either abandon withers entirely or create compound withers, which offer even more room for bugs to hide in. So, yeah, manual withers work, but they're not great. And if Java wants us to use records every way they belong, it would be nice if it made those copies easier. And that's where JEP 468 comes in. JEP 468 proposes to derive new record instances from existing ones with a new with expression. A with expression starts with a so-called origin expression, which must be of a record type, in most cases which will be just a reference to a record variable. It's followed by the situational keyword with, and ends with a transformation block, a pair of curly braces that can contain almost arbitrary code. The type of the whole expression is that of the origin expression, so you can, for example, assign it to a variable of the same type as the initial record variable. So for a record point int x and y, that could be point updated equals old with x equals 0. At runtime, Java will evaluate the origin expression to the so-called origin value. It will then take that record and create a variable for each component with the same type, name, and value as given by the accessor, and make these local component variables available in the transformation block. It will then run the block, whose chief job it is to reassign some or even all of them. Technically, we can execute almost arbitrary code, but we should really stick to succinctly computing and assigning new values. It's okay if that takes some control structures or method calls, but we really shouldn't include any logic here that isn't strictly necessary to achieve the goal. Once the block ran its course, the canonical constructor of the record type will be called with the local component values, thus giving you a new record instance that is like the old, except for the components for which you just computed new values. Calling the constructor also ensures that all constraints are checked. You cannot create any illegal record instances this way. So for the record point and x and y and the statement point updated equals old with x equals 0, updated's x coordinate is 0 and its y coordinate is whatever old had. I said almost arbitrary code twice now. The most important limitation is that control flow cannot be passed outside the block with the return, yield, break, or continue. The block must either complete normally or throw an exception. It's really cool that the block only needs to contain the minimum amount of code necessary to change the state between the two records. All unchanged state flows through it without being mentioned, and so a small transformation is small. This minimalism mirrors that of compact record constructors, who also alleviate us of boilerplate, in this case assigning values to fields, and also focuses on what's relevant, in this case the values that need to be checked, whereas other data just flows through them without being mentioned. I thought that was a pretty witty observation. A shame half of you zoned out, and instead of listening to me having an original thought for once, were wondering what would happen if the block is empty. In that case, you just get a copy of the record with the same values. And just to make sure you can focus on the next part, where I make a connection to named parameters, let me also clarify that you can nest with expressions. So for a record line, point start, point end, you can create an instance's copy that's on the x-axis by setting starts and ends y-coordinate to 0 with the block line x-axis equals line with, and now in curly braces, you reassign start and end. Start equals start with y equals 0, and end equals end with y equals 0. If you squint really hard and look through a frosted glass of wishful thinking, and then poke yourself in the eyes, you might think this looks like named parameters for constructors. But it's really not. It's just a block of code that prepares variables for an eventual constructor call. Whatever, I can hear a few of you say, heading into the weeds, all I need is a readily available default instance of my record, and I can create all other instances with that instance with assignments, and then the assignments look like named record parameters. And you're not wrong. You can do that, and it can lead to a nice API. I should know, I already have one that is purpose-built for this exact approach. It models HTML. A paragraph, for example, is a paragraph record, and I declare a p variable that has all components set to null. Then I can create a paragraph with a certain ID, for example, with p with curly braces ID equals my ID. But this only works because a paragraph without any information is a legal value in the domain of HTML and the obvious default instance of a paragraph record, and so I can use it in that idiom. But it is essential to stick to this order of events. First the constraints, then the identification of an obvious default instances, and then the cool with construction. If you loosen the constraints, even the tiniest bit, or anoint one of several reasonable defaults as the chosen one, you hurt your code's correctness and maintainability and readability for zero material benefit. Please don't do this! And if you're wondering whether this at least opens the door towards named parameters, I got a disappointing link in the description for you to a mail from Brian Goetz. But I can even do you one better. Here's Brian Goetz disappointing you on video in an AMA he recorded last fall. I'll see you again in 4 weeks. Until then, so long! Are there any plans for named arguments, even for limited applications like record constructors?
Yeah, so named arguments is the one that comes up a lot. And there's a subtle tension here. Mm-hmm. So like record constructors are a great example of a place where we could use named arguments because the names are actually part of the record specification. Yeah. Whereas constructor arguments, their names are not actually significant. You're allowed to rename them freely, and that's binary and source compatible. But records, the names are part of the API, and so we could do that. So why wouldn't we do that? One of the reasons why we might not do that is we want there to be a path for refactoring from records to classes.
Mm-hmm.
Because we saw this with enums, where enums are great, but it happens every so often. Yep. That you write an enum that, like, you're starting to reach the limits of what I can do as an enum, and I have to refactor it to a class. And that's doable. It's sad, but it's doable. And the important thing is you want that refactoring to be compatible. You don't want to have to go change all the clients in this class because you had to do this internal refactoring. And with records, if like all these other client classes had invocations of new foo, A colon this, B colon that, now when you refactor from a record to a class, you break all that code. And so, like, the next question you might ask is, like, okay, well, can we have this for classes as well? And here's where it gets more complicated, because now we have to invent a mechanism that says, most of the time, parameter names don't mean anything, but for this class, really, I promise, I'll never change these, right? And the story doesn't end there, right? Because if we had that for records and for classes, the next question that someone asks is, gee, this constructor has 19 arguments, but, you know, 18 of them have good defaults.
Can't I
specify default arguments too? And, like, now we're starting to talk about things that are possible but very significant investments, right? Mm-hmm. So named invocation of record constructors, not actually that hard to do. Doing default values for method and constructor invocations starts to run into problems with overload selection and compatibility, because, you know, let's pull on the string some more. Now I've given you a constructor that has 18 arguments and 17 of them have defaults. It will be impossible for you to not think, well, I have 18, it must be okay to add a 19th as long as there's a default. And now, unless we completely change the way we translate method invocations and do everything with invoke dynamic, which we could, now I've broken all of my clients.
Right, it's because it's still changing the signature of the method.
Exactly.
And so in the bytecode, we'll still say, call the constructor with the 18 arguments, which now doesn't exist anymore.
Which no longer exists, yeah. And so this is a good example of, like, when people only have a view of the programming language from the source code perspective, they think, oh, well, it should be harmless to add a 19th parameter with a default. After all, I'm giving it a default. And they don't think about how does this translate into the class file? What are the compatibility expectations of, you know, people who are linking to this jar that I distributed 5 years ago? And that starts to become a significant feature. You know, I could do it, but then I'd have to not do something else. And I don't think this is as valuable as some of the other things we can do.
So not enough bang for the buck. Yeah, and it's also interesting, like, this sequence of, well, the first step is kind of easy to have, but then you want to take the next, and they get progressively harder.
Yes.
It doesn't make sense to take the first step just because it's easy,
yes,
and then end up in a potentially even more unsatisfying situation.
Yeah. I was joking how my job is to say no to all of these things, right? You know, the reason I do is I have to think it through of, like, not just this question, but what's the next 10 questions, and does that lead us to a language we like or not? And if it doesn't lead us to a language we like, we can't take that first step.
Yeah, good point.